Hi, Brian Lehrer here. Up next, Brian Lehrer Weekend, three of our favorite segments from the week packaged together for you to listen to on the weekend. So enjoy, and I'll see you back on the radio Monday at 10 a.m. on WNYC and WNYC.org. Brian Lehrer Show on WNYC. Good morning, everyone. So if you haven't heard this story yet, check this out. It looks like Democrats in the New York State Legislature are doing their best this week to help Democrats keep their majority in the United States Congress. So how can a state legislature do that, you might ask? The answer is redistricting. Stay with me on this because it's a little complicated, but it's really interesting. After a failed attempt at bipartisan redistricting in New York, the Democratic majority in Albany has released maps of new congressional districts for the state that could actually box out three Republicans who now serve in Congress and see them replaced by Democrats this November. That includes the one district in New York City now represented by a Republican, that is Staten Island, and a little bit of Brooklyn represented by Republican Nicole Malliotakis. The new proposed district would include more of Brooklyn to create a likely Democratic majority. Districts on Long Island would become more likely to elect Democrats too, as well as a few upstate. The reason that New York Democrats can do this is that redistricting happens every 10 years, the year after the census. That's the years on the ones, so the years on the twos, 2022 after the 2020 census. Every state is doing it. New York's legislature has a Democratic supermajority in both houses these days, so they're doing this because they can. Now, if it seems like a partisan power grab, it probably is. But the context is not just New York, it's national. Republican-controlled states redistricted aggressively for their party's benefit in 2011, 2012. Democrats currently hold a smaller percentage of seats in Congress than their percentage of total voters. Think about that. Democrats currently hold a smaller percentage of seats in Congress than their percentage of total voters in the country. In 2016, for example, according to the Brookings Institution, Republicans got 51% of all votes for House of Representatives, but 55% of the seats. Brookings says that meant they had 21 seats in the House, more than they should have, with a perfect percentage match. That's a lot of seats. Brookings called the House of Representatives not so representative. And looking nationally this year, as every state is doing this now, the website 538, which does a lot of data, a lot of counting, says Republicans have gained a handful of House seats through the redistricting process so far in 2022. It says Republicans have also converted light red districts into safer seats in states like Indiana, Oklahoma, South Carolina, and Utah. One other X factor before we bring in our guest. Challenges in court. Beyond a certain point, districts can get struck down as illegal gerrymandering. But the courts usually defer to state legislatures. For example, in 2018, we covered this at the time, the Supreme Court upheld most of the pro-Republican redistricting in Texas, a ruling described by the Texas Tribune as a blow to civil rights groups, voters of color, and Democratic lawmakers who had been fighting the Republican-controlled legislature's adjustment of district boundaries since 2011. With us now, the number two Democrat in the New York State Senate, who is also taking the lead on the redistricting plan, which might be voted on tomorrow, Senator Michael Gennaris, whose district begins like a big wide bell in Astoria in northwest Queens and ends as a skinny little panhandle in southeast Queens down by Ozone Park. Senator, always good to have you on. Welcome back to WNYC.
Good morning, Brian. I should mention that my district looks that way because the Republicans a decade ago gerrymandered it to look that way.
Well, there you go. So the New York Times article on this calls your plan starkly partisan. The left-leaning Brennan Center for Justice is quoted in City and State saying Democrats took a heavy hand for an aggressive gerrymander. How much do you agree or disagree with the Times and the Brennan Center?
Well, look, the important thing to realize is New York is a deep blue state. We all know this. It's well known nationally. And so it shouldn't be a surprise that when maps are drawn fairly, there's going to be a result that reflects that reality on the ground. And so we have very strict rules here in New York that we operate under when these lines are drawn. And among them is the lines are not drawn for the purpose of benefiting a party or a particular individual. We believe we have complied with those rules. The courts ultimately will hear this for the first time because these are new standards in New York, and we'll make our case as to why we think what we did is proper. Our lawyers have looked at this backwards and forwards, so we have great confidence that what we did is appropriate.
Well, the Times article, and I'm not even quoting the New York Post article, you can imagine what they say, but the Times article says the map immediately exposed Democrats to charges that they were engaging in the same kind of gerrymandering that many in the party have denounced as anti-democratic and accused Republicans of carrying out elsewhere. You just accused them of carrying it out in your own district.
Sure.
10 years ago. So do you argue that what you're doing is any different from that?
There's no question that they have been doing it. They've been doing it aggressively for decades. They have been the leaders in this game. But what's happening in New York is as we unravel the gerrymanders of the past, it doesn't make it a gerrymander of today. These are districts that are drawn fairly, and if they had been drawn fairly at the outset, this is perhaps what they would have looked like. But because we are living in a world influenced by decades of Republican control of the Senate where they influence these lines, this is how it appears relative to what we're facing in the current line. So, for example, there's been a lot of talk of District 11, the Staten Island-based seat, and what we're doing with it. Well, the map that we have drawn is quite similar to the way that district existed in the 70s. And it was gerrymandered in the 80s to help Guy Molinari, and they eliminated a Democratic congressman, Leo Zeffiretti, at the time, for partisan reasons. So as we're unraveling the mistakes of the past, not even a mistake, it was intentional, but as we're unraveling the gerrymandering of the past, we're just bringing things back to where they should have been from the outset.
And I want to get into that Staten Island plus parts of Brooklyn district in more detail. We'll get into some Long Island districts in more detail, even one Long Island district that will suddenly include parts of the Bronx and Westchester as you've drawn it. But to continue to quote from the Times article in general, it says Democratic gains could help offset those that Republicans are expected to rack up in red states like Texas, Florida, and Georgia. That's the contemporary context. You talk about undoing the things of the past. These things are going on right now, as we all know. And I guess, you know, some supporters of your approach, and we've gotten calls like this, just say out loud, yes, this is what Democratic states have to do so you don't have unilateral disarmament. We already have a tweet. Let's see. Here it is, at Brian Lehrer. Why should New York unilaterally disarm when Republicans are, they use a word we can't say on the radio, us everywhere? So there's that term that I was citing, unilateral disarmament. When that kind of thing is going on, you know, someday when there's some kind of national agreement on nonpartisan redistricting, if that day ever comes, then you can back off as well. But if the Republican legislatures around the country are going to go all in for their partisan advantage in Congress, this argument says you're really obligated to your constituents to do the same thing in New York and other blue states. Would it be bad to just say that directly out loud like
that? I'll leave the political analysis to others. I mean, that's a school of thought. What I know is we have some very strict requirements in New York that we have to comply with, and those include not drawing the maps for the express purpose of benefiting a particular individual, a particular political party, and we have complied with those rules. So you said things are going on right now. They certainly are in other states, and they have gone on in New York in the past. But my point simply was if you look at a map drawn today and you compare it to the map that exists yesterday, that's not a fair comparison because the map that existed yesterday was gerrymandered. And so if that was drawn fairly as it should have been decades ago or at the outset of this whole process, the maps may well have looked like what we just came up with. And so it's not a fair assessment to say, well, look, this district, you know, 10 changed so much from what it was yesterday, because we're living in an unfair environment to begin with.
So listeners, who has a question or comment about drawing new congressional districts in New York State? The other levels of government are getting their districts drawn too, but there's so much at stake nationally in these midterm elections that we're focusing for this conversation on the most contentious aspect of this, and with the most at stake, the congressional districts. So who has a question or a comment about the once a decade process going on right now? 212-433-WNYC, 433-9692, or you can tweet at Brian Lehrer. Political cartographers, come with your competing maps, or any constituent, come with a thought or a question about your current representative or district line and what you would like to see or not. 212-433-WNYC, or tweet at Brian Lehrer for the second ranking Democrat in the New York State Senate, Michael Janaris of Queens. All right, let's look at some of the specific districts that your proposed map withdraw. You mentioned the one involving Staten Island. The news organization City and State has an article on this with a blunt headline: Representative Nicole Malliotakis is probably screwed. Fair or unfair?
Unfair, as we discussed already. And by the way, in terms of the political consequences of a lot of what we've done, we can sit here and predict outcomes, but the voters have the final say. And so there's been a lot of analysis already just in one day about that district and what it might mean. And some people say if the Democrats nominate someone who's further of a particular political persuasion through the primary, because the district has changed so much, it might not be to their benefit in the general election. Others say it will be. But my point is simply, we don't know what the outcomes are going to be until the voters have their say. So there's a lot of prognosticating going on that is unwarranted at this point. I know that's what we all do.
But you know how different neighborhoods have voted in the recent past. So you can make some predictions based on that, right?
Sure. But there's two elections, right? There's a primary election to nominate a candidate, and there's a general election. And the way these districts are drawn can have different effects on each of those. And my point is simply, like, we just don't know. And to sit there and say we can draw the maps with full knowledge of where they're going to end up is not accurate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. Maybe not full knowledge. But the City and State article says the district you've proposed, including Staten Island, adds the Democratic bastions, says Democratic bastions, of Sunset Park, Park Slope, and Gowanus. So what do you say to the people? Well, what do you say to the people of Staten Island, which voted Trump for president in a greater percentage than the state of Texas did, that you're making them a minority based on past votes, in a way that will likely guarantee a Democrat gets elected from there, and as a kind of disenfranchisement of Staten Island's electoral power?
Well, again, I would say that we don't know the outcome, so let me just repeat that again. But I would say to people who are concerned about Staten Island, the math is what it is. Staten Island does not have enough population to fill out an entire congressional district. Once you get to that point, you realize they have to add population from somewhere. In the past, it's been connected to Manhattan, where you'd probably get the same criticism of related to what we've done. It has been more recently connected to South Brooklyn, Coney Island, and that area. And in the past as well, it has been drawn the way we drew it, which connects through Bay Ridge and Sunset Park and surrounding neighborhoods. So over time, different map drawers have taken different approaches to find the extra territory that's needed to fill out District 11. We chose one that has historical precedent. And to do it otherwise, Brian, you'd have to say, well, Staten Island tends to vote Republican, so let's go find Republicans to make sure that district continues to elect a Republican. That is gerrymandering by definition. That is prohibited, actually. If we did it that way, that map would correctly be eliminated in the courts. The point is, you're supposed to find neighborhoods that make sense. If you follow Staten Island over the Verrazano Bridge and you just continue the line straight up, the map actually looks very clean. It is a contiguous district. It is compact, much more so than if it branched out either east or west. And so I think we've done the right thing there.
Let me read you two tweets that have come in from listeners, and maybe you can answer them together. One says, Let's have some honesty here and not act like this is a mission to provide accurate voting lines from the 70s. What does Park Slope and Staten Island have in common that need to be represented? So that's a specific question. And then someone else tweets a more general question. What is a fair district? What are the principles in this process?
Well, the principles are many and they're new in New York. We changed our standards after the previous redistricting. And now we have a whole litany of standards that we must meet in the Constitution and in statutes in New York. They include compactness, contiguity, not disenfranchising communities of interest, and not drawing the lines to benefit a particular individual or to hurt a particular individual, and not drawing the lines to the benefit or detriment of political parties generally. And there are others, but there is quite a lengthy list of standards that have to be complied with. Maintaining the core of existing districts is also on the list of considerations that that we have to comply with. And so we have done all that. And the reason I bring up the 70s is simply to say this district has been all over the place because Staten Island has a certain population, and you need to add to that to fill out a district. It has been attached to Lower Manhattan, and that was one of the proposals that others have made for this scenario. And so had we done that, I don't think the criticism would be any less. The point is that people that don't like what has happened in District 11 only want us to go seek out specifically conservative-inclined voters to make sure that they can continue to elect a Republican. That is gerrymandering, not what we've done.
Why would they not be considered a community of interest, as you use that term, if they're a kind of substantial political minority? You know, Trump got, if we just measure by the presidential election, he got more than a quarter of the votes in New York City. And the party will likely have no seats from New York City.
I don't mean to interrupt your question, Brian, but ideology is not a community of interest. In fact, drawing lines for a specific partisan outcome is expressly prohibited. And so if what you're suggesting is that we go find people who vote the same way as people on Staten Island vote, that's prohibited.
And to the specific question, what do Park Slope and Staten Island have in common that need to be represented, that listener?
And if I may, I'll get to that question as well, but we talk about Staten Island as if it's a monolithic group. Max Rose was the congressman from there, a Democrat, in recent history.
Yeah, just like
so it's
2 years
not as
ago.
If their voting patterns are set in stone and are unchanged, right? So
yes.
The critique is not well-founded. What does Park Slope have to do with Staten Island? As I mentioned to you, we come off of Staten Island. We follow the Verrazano. It spills into Bay Ridge. And then you attach neighborhoods from there. You can go east. You can go north. You can go west. And all have been suggested. As I mentioned, it's been suggested we make a tri-county, tri-borough district that goes into Manhattan from there. We took what we thought was the geographically simplest route and just kept moving in the same direction until we got the population we needed. That took us up through Sunset Park and into Park Slope.
Before we go on to Long Island and some other districts, just to finish on District 11, City and State also reports on concerns about dilution of Latino political power in the new district because Sunset Park would be moved into that Staten Island plus Brooklyn district, taken away from Congressman Nydia Velazquez's current district. So you might get a white, more centrist Democrat like Max Rose, who used to be the congressman from there, as you mentioned. City Council member Alexa Aviles is quoted expressing concern that the newly elected Democrat could well be, quote, not deeply connected to the interests of our community. What do you say to the people, and particularly the Latino people of Sunset Park?
Again, getting in the business of predicting outcomes is a very a tenuous way to go about this. There is a Latina, as I understand it, also competing in the primary in that district to be nominated and may well be. I don't know how the voters in that district are going to vote at the end of the day. Some would say her ideology is more relatable to the people of Park Slope. So we just don't know is my simple point. There's going to be elections. The voters will have their say. And as it relates to Congressmember Velazquez's district, we took great care to make sure that the Latino population in that district was not diminished or diluted. It will continue to have its plurality status in that district.
We're going to continue in a minute with State Senator Michael Janaris, the number two state senator in New York, who's also leading this redistricting mapping project. They may vote on it tomorrow and approve all these new district lines that we've begun to talk about for Congress. We'll get into districts from Long Island, Westchester, the Bronx, more of Brooklyn. Callers, I see you. Melissa in Mount Vernon asking if AOC is going to be redistricted out of Congress. We see you. We'll take your call. Karen in Brooklyn, we see you. Why have they thrown out the maps from the Independent Commission that was supposed to end partisan districting? And others, stay with us. More with Senator Janaris in a minute. Brian Lehrer on WNYC as we continue with the number two member of the New York State Senate, Democrat Michael Janaris from Queens, who's leading the once-in-a-decade redistricting process, which the New York Times and others say could remove three Republican seats from Congress, perhaps the biggest change, say some of the press reports I've been reading, of any state in this once-a-decade redistricting year, and with obviously high-stakes midterm elections coming in November. Melissa in Mount Vernon, you're on WNYC. Hi, Melissa.
Hi. New York has lost a lot of population and we're losing a congressional seat. Is it true that AOC's district is being cut up?
Is it true? No, it's not true. It remains largely the same. It's still a Bronx-Queens district. Because everyone has to gain population, as the caller pointed out, there's some movement around the borders. I think she gains some more of Queens in the proposal. And other than that, it's a very similar district to what she currently has.
All right. Karen in Brooklyn, you're on WNYC. Hi, Karen.
Hi, Brian. Thanks for taking my call. Well, Senator, I wanted to ask why you threw out, it seems, all the maps that were put together by the Independent Redistricting Commission. It seems clear that you guys at LAPFOR, you know, have been working on these maps right along. Listeners should know that the way the commission was set up was that if they couldn't agree on maps, it was going to go back to the legislature so they could draw their own. And so I think the whole process
And that's what happened.
That's what happened. But let me just ask you a specific at one of our hearings in Brooklyn. We had people in South Brooklyn saying, we don't want to be connected to Jerry Nadler's district, which is primarily on the Upper West Side. And that's where his, focus is. And I noticed in the new map that you continue to create this tiny snaking district throughout Brooklyn that connects Nadler's district, again, primarily Upper West Side of Manhattan, all the way down to some of the primarily Orthodox Jewish districts, I believe it is, in southern Brooklyn. Why is
Borough
that
Park.
Still happening? People said they didn't want that. Yes.
Yeah, there were conflicting testimonies about that. Other people said they did want the communities of the Upper West Side and parts of Brooklyn, particularly Borough Park, in the same district. The key word that the caller mentioned, which is correct, he said we continue to draw it that way. And as I mentioned to you earlier, Brian, one of the criteria we're required to use is maintaining the cores of existing districts. And so in an effort to do that, we took this rendering of that district, which was drawn by a judge last time, and we essentially kept it in the same configuration.
Now, Nadler's district, to be fair to you, wasn't just primarily the Upper West Side of Manhattan. It was from there all the way down to the end of Manhattan. He represents the World Trade Center, for example, and then into Brooklyn. But now that district does go to Borough Park, which it didn't before. That won't change the partisan makeup of it. It would still likely be Democratic.
Correction there, Brian. It does go to Borough Park currently.
That's what I'm saying. It currently goes to Borough Park? I thought that part was new. Did I miss-see that? All right. But I've seen that discussed and reviewed as, you know, more sympathetically perhaps than some of the other changes, as giving Hasidic New Yorkers a religious minority or Jewish New Yorkers, but I think particularly aimed at Hasidic New Yorkers, some stronger electoral power as a religious minority. Do you not see it that way?
Well, what I would say is there is a recognized community of interest that has driven that district to look the way it does, and that's why it looks that way in its existing configuration, and we maintained that approach going forward.
And to the caller Karen's point about the bipartisan redistricting commission that failed to agree on a bipartisan endorsed set of congressional maps, that's why we're here now with you going your own way and the Democratic majority. Other states, apparently, red and blue alike, are having the same issue. So do you think nonpartisan redistricting is a nice idea in theory, but nobody will ever actually do it?
I think it's a nice idea in theory. I think it could be a good idea in practice. I think California has an approach which is working much better. But the thing to remember is our process was flawed at its origin. It was never nonpartisan. It was bipartisan. It was five appointees essentially from each party. And when you do that, that's akin to the way the Board of Elections works, right? If you have the same number of votes, so to speak, from each party, it's designed for deadlock. And this was designed by then-Governor Cuomo and the Senate Republicans. This was their formula for how to do redistricting. And I remember this because I was around back then and fought it very hard to set up something actually independent and nonpartisan. They gave us something where the parties are supposed to act on as checks on each other, and inevitably you end up with 5-5 deadlocks on everything, and that's what we were dealing with. It was a process designed to fail. Critics are right about that, but it was designed by the Republicans a decade ago, and so this is the outcome that they've driven. I hope before the next redistricting comes around, we're able to alter the process and make it truly independent.
Let's go on to Long Island. City and state describe the east end of the island district, now represented by Republican Lee Zeldin, as being altered to extend more west into Nassau County, which is more Democratic, putting that seat in play and concentrating the Republican South Shore communities in Suffolk into Republican Andrew Garbarino's district, pretty much guaranteeing Republican control there by making it harder for Republicans in Zeldin's district. Fair description?
Now, mind you, Brian, this criticism is directly at odds with the criticism we were talking about earlier in the Staten Island District scenario. You were just asking me, why didn't we go find like-minded people and put them in the same district? And the critique of this is that we found like-minded people and put them all in the same district on the South Shore. So it's...
Well,
it's,
the goal was
it exposes,
to... The
but,
goal,
but, it
but the goal... The premise is that the goal was to put more Democrats in Lee Zeldin's district.
Well, no, but this is my point. What we did was we united the communities on the South Shore, which everyone can agree are communities of interest.
Meaning.
Well, I'm not. No, we do not look at it that way, as I made clear earlier. But they are certainly communities that share a lot in terms of how their communities deal with issues they're facing, the fact that they do contain shoreline and have a variety of factors that make them like-minded, not politically, but just in terms of the issues their communities face. And once you, a lot of the questions we get are driven by things that happen around these districts. So you can look at any district in a vacuum and say, why does this one turn east here and west there? But sometimes it's because we're doing things in the districts around them that are forcing those decisions. And so once you create a South Shore district, it kind of moves the districts around it in a particular direction.
And the district currently represented by Democratic Congressman Tom Suozzi, who's probably giving it up to run for governor, that's currently a North Shore district extending from northeast Queens around Bayside and Little Neck out to the North Shore of Suffolk County around Huntington. Now that district will add very Democratic parts of Westchester and the Bronx. So can you argue that those communities have enough in common with the, you know, let's say, private home, pretty affluent North Shore communities to make sense for them to all be represented by the same person?
Well, certainly you can make that argument. These are all suburban, Long Island Sound bordering neighborhoods. But again, this is all driven, and I want to take a step back and mm-hmm. give you the origin story, so to speak, of how we ended up where we did.
Sure.
This is driven by the geography of the state. So you start at the east end of Long Island, you start building out your districts, and each congressional district has to have basically the exact same number of population. So you start building as many districts as you can. The state bottlenecks where the Bronx meets Westchester. And so you get up to that point in the map, and there's a certain amount of population that's still needed to fill out whatever district hits there. So inevitably, under any scenario, under any map that's been proposed, a New York City district has to spill into Westchester. And at that point, your options are limited. And if you tinker with some, you potentially have issues with communities of interest, minority communities that need to maintain their pluralities or majority status in some of these other districts that could have potentially crossed over. And so in the end, we actually took this idea from the public testimony. One of the previous callers said, you know, we didn't pay attention to the public testimony of the commission or whatever it was. That's completely false, because this was a specific suggestion of a group that was concerned about minority representation, and this was how they configured this district.
By the way, on AOC, here's something from the Queen's Eagle for that listener and other listeners interested in or concerned about her congressional district. The Queen's Eagle says Ocasio-Cortez picks up the progressive Queens voters that Congresswoman Carolyn Maloney loses under the proposed maps. She also picks up voters in Whitestone, who recently elected Republican Vicky Palladino to the city council. However, the proposed map brings more Democratic voters into the district. Anything else to say about Congresswoman Ocasio-Cortez's district?
No, that sounds to me like we did it fairly. You just said we added some progressive voters, we added some conservative voters, and so every district had to change, at least at the margins. And so it sounds like in that case, we did it in a way that brought in people of all types of persuasions to fill out that number.
Jay in northern New Jersey, I think, wants to say, way to go, Michael Janaris. Jay, you're on WNYC. Hello.
Hello. I love your show, and I think shows like this really help promote democracy, and by the exchange of ideas, maybe we can get past all this partisanship, which is poisoning our country. I think we have to approach the problem of redistricting in a totally neutral fashion. If we leave it up to politicians, that is party bosses, we're always going to get partisanship. And partisanship is poisoning this country. So what we need to do is have an independent commission that's truly independent. You have to scrutinize who sits on such a commission to make sure that they are neutral.
The problem is, Jay, who's neutral and who's going to appoint them who is neutral? And so maybe it's an impossible task.
Well, seemingly it is impossible. But don't forget, we have people appointed to the judiciary. They're supposed to be neutral. They're not chosen because they're left or they're right. They might be chosen because of party membership, okay? But, you know, judges are supposed to be neutral people. When somebody sits as a judge, they're an umpire. They're not a Yankees fan. They're not a Red Sox fan. They're the umpire. And that's what we have to strive for.
And we know that's imperfect, but I definitely take your point. One more, Phil in Mendham. You're on WNYC. Hi, Phil.
Hi. I'm excited to ask a question of you two gentlemen that I've always wondered. How come nobody has ever advocated for some neutral computer program that just basically superimposes a bunch of identical square districts throughout the country and let the chips fall where they may? Because I'm aware right now that there's this huge disparity between the popular vote that goes to the Democrats in Congress compared to the actual electoral success of the Democrats. So the first thing I think is that fair districting would be, I'm sorry to say, a boon to Democrats, because right now the Democrats are getting the short end of the stick on.
Right,
on
they have more people who voted for Congress total nationwide as a percentage than the percentage of seats that they have in the House because of the history of Republican gerrymandering. So Phil is asking, why not have a computer program do it? Maybe that's the neutral umpire that the previous caller was going for.
Well, it would certainly be neutral, but the question is that really what we want to do? Because county lines, county borders don't follow squares. State borders don't follow squares. So what happens when you reach the corner of a state? You'd have a representative from New York and Pennsylvania. It's just not the way communities exist. And when you're looking for communities that need representation, that, I mean, we talk a lot about communities of interest, which is a legal construct, but when you're talking about communities of interest, those don't always fall in square shapes.
You're going to have to go to court, apparently, with these. Republicans will almost certainly take some of these districts to court. City and state quotes at least three progressive-leaning sources who won't predict victory in court for you with any confidence. Eljoy Williams, who heads the Brooklyn NAACP, Democratic consultant Camille Rivera, and Michael Lee from the Brennan Center. Did you support the lawsuit that made it to the Supreme Court against Texas's partisan redistricting? The Supreme Court allowed that redistricting to stand. Did you ever say anything supporting the lawsuit against that?
No, I mean, we have our hands full here in New York, but I was a supporter of the lawsuit we filed 10 years ago when the lines in New York were gerrymandered. Litigation is inevitable and guaranteed every time there's a redistricting. There's always suits, multiple suits usually, and the courts will hear it out at the end of the day. We have had lawyers look at these maps backwards and forwards, and when the time comes, we're confident we'll make our case to the court and be successful.
All right. Before you go, let me touch briefly on two other issues before you in the legislature. Mayor Eric Adams wants bail reform amended, as you know, to allow judges to consider the dangerousness of the defendant, as he says they can in all 49 other states. Many states have no cash bail at all, but judicial discretion on dangerousness to keep somebody in jail before trial. Are you open to that kind of revision? You would have a lot of power over it.
Well, first of all, let's take a step back again. The conversation around bail reform has gotten so twisted that any criminal activity that occurs is laid at the feet of bail reform. I just saw a tweet from a member of Congress today, someone who should know better, who cited an article about someone who committed a crime and said, look at this person. This person was out on bail. Bail reform has failed. If the person is out on bail, that means they were granted bail under the old system. Okay? And now it's just gotten to the point where everything lands at the feet of bail reform. Let's look at the real data.
Right. That wasn't
data
no bail. That was bail. Yeah.
Correct. It was paid. And by the way, the incident that the mayor himself cited just a couple of days ago was someone who was out on $250,000 bail. Those are examples of why the bail system needed reforming, not the fact that what we did was flawed.
But I think the mayor's example said, yeah, cash should not be the barrier to getting out while you're waiting for trial, and it should not be a ticket to get out while you're waiting for trial if the judge sees you as a danger to the community.
Right, but the thing to remember about New York is people are talking about, you know, 10 years ago and 15 years ago as if they were incredibly safe, and they were. And we never had that kind of standard then. So we can be safe. We know how to do this. We have done it without using a dangerousness standard, which every scholar who has looked at this will tell you is applied in a way that is discriminatory. When you give a judge on a bench the power to just say, I deem you to be dangerous, without a trial, by the way, that's what a trial is for. Everything we're talking about related to bail is pre-trial. These are unconvicted people at that point in the process.
Correct.
Innocent unless proven guilty, we're all taught, right? But somehow when it comes to bail, people just want to throw people in jail, lock away the key. Maybe they did it, maybe they didn't. And we're just going to let a judge decide on their own whether someone is dangerous or not. And that has proven to be applied very discriminatorily. And
so
a lot of people have a problem with that. But we do know, Brian, that we have real data on how bail reform is working. And we're seeing that less than 2% of people who are out under the bail reform laws are reoffending or being charged, I should say, with serious crimes. That is less than the reoffense rate in other contexts. So it's actually working as intended.
And last question, the revisions to the affordable housing tax break for developers known as 421A. As I understand it, Governor Hochul has proposed to replace the current system, which provides a complete tax break for rental buildings with affordable housing, with a new plan which keeps the tax break with modest changes to require affordable apartments go to lower income New Yorkers and allow the tax break to be used for lower priced condos. But progressives like Comptroller Brad Lander want the tax break ended. So what's your position on the Hochul proposal or the Lander response?
I think my concern with the proposal is it is just modest changes. 421A is a boondoggle for wealthy developers and has not done very much to increase the affordable housing stock. The levels of affordability are often actually unaffordable. And so we need more than just modest changes to this program. We should end it and start all over with a new approach.
You think that's the position of the legislature's majority, so Hochul won't get her way as is on this?
I only speak for myself until we discuss it as a conference, and we have yet to do that.
State Senator Michael Gennaris, the number two ranking state senator, representing parts of Queens and having drawn or participated heavily in drawing these congressional districting maps, which may get voted on tomorrow. Is it tomorrow? Have you scheduled a vote?
Yeah, I believe it's tomorrow.
Thank you so much for your time and standing for all these questions. We really appreciate it.
Always a pleasure, Brian. Thanks so much.
It's the Brian Lehrer Show on WNYC. Good morning again, everyone. Congressman Ro Khanna is with us. He's a leader in the House Progressive Caucus, a deputy whip, as they call it. His district covers much of Silicon Valley, the biggest tech hub of the United States, as we all know, including San Jose, Santa Clara, Cupertino, and other places around there. Ro Khanna is the son of immigrant parents from India and is a Yale Law School grad. The progressive newspaper The Guardian calls him by far the most tech-savvy member of Congress, and it says even more remarkable for a congressman whose district includes Apple, Google, Intel, and Yahoo. Khanna is one of the few who refuses to take campaign money from political action committees. And Congressman Ro Khanna has a new book called Dignity in a Digital Age, Making Tech Work for All of Us. So we'll talk about how possible that is and how he thinks we can get there, and also about the politics of this moment in 2022 and the implications of the politics of right now for control of Congress in November. Congressman Khanna, thanks so much for making this one of your stops. Welcome to WNYC.
I'm honored to be on. I appreciate your work, particularly after the Fairness Doctrine was repealed and trying to improve public discourse. So I'm looking forward to the conversation.
Thank you for being a little familiar with the show. And for people not from your district around the country or who haven't seen you much in your national media appearances, which are many, do I have it right that you didn't grow up around Silicon Valley, but rather in Bucks County, Pennsylvania, north of Philly, just across the New Jersey line?
I was born there, raised there, went to Council Rock High School there till I was 18. I was born in Philadelphia, actually, in our bicentenary year in 1976. And my folks are still in Bucks County.
And what brought you to Silicon Valley?
During law school, I was enamored by what was going on there. I thought the most interesting questions of law would be at the intersection of technology and law. There was a professor, Larry Lessig, who wrote one of the most brilliant books, Code, where he argued that engineers were actually making the decisions for us in how to structure society. I did work for him and then went out to Silicon Valley to see what the place was like.
A brilliant man, Lawrence Lessig, who's been on the show, among everything else that he's done. The Guardian review of your book says you're right with the idealism and optimism of a first-generation American who still marvels at the opportunities he has had. Would you describe yourself that way?
Yes, I would. We have my story. My grandfather spent 15 years in India's independence movement, 4 years in jail alongside Gandhi during the 1940s, during Quit India. My parents then immigrated here, and they came after the civil rights movement. I mean, until 1965, as 90% of immigration was European because we had strict quotas for people from India or China. I was born, as I mentioned, in Philadelphia, our bicentenary. And then at the age of 40, this country elects me to represent arguably the most economically prosperous place in the world. And it's a district that's majority Asian American. Anyone who has my story, I think, would have an optimism, a hope about America. That doesn't mean I'm unaware of the injustices and the struggles and also fate and restrictions on other communities that have been much severer than that I've faced. But it does give me a hope for the country to become a multiracial, multiethnic democracy.
Yeah, I actually want you to talk about that a little more because optimism is, let's say, not dominant in our national mood these days, including among progressives who often focus on the persistence of racism and inequality and right-wing threats to democracy. So how do you integrate that into what you see as your progressive worldview, your optimism and your progressiveness?
If there's one thing I hope your listeners will read after this interview, more than my book, it is Frederick Douglass's Composite Nation, which I end the book with in chapter 10. I think next to the Lincoln's inaugurals, it may be one of the greatest speeches in American history. And here you have Frederick Douglass, who was a slave for 20 years, who was enslaved for 20 years, defending in 1869 Chinese immigration. And he says that he still has belief, a belief that America will become a multiracial, multiethnic democracy, a composite nation, as he says, with people from all over the world, including African Americans, and that we all would have an ability to contribute as equals to building this composite nation. And I guess my view is, if you have people like Frederick Douglass or W.E.B. Du Bois, who talks about the aspiration of all Americans to be co-workers in the kingdom of culture, or my late colleague John Lewis, who was beaten on the Edmund Pettus Bridge, or my grandfather, who spent 4 years in jail against colonialism, if you have all of those individuals believing in the possibility of freedom and sacrificing for it, it seems our challenges seem rather insignificant, or not as significant as what they had to overcome. It would be the height of complacency for us to embrace a doomerism when the odds of our struggle are less than what people have had to endure before us.
It's good to have a long view of history. Congressman Ro Khanna, our guest, the subtitle of your book, How Tech Can Work for All of Us. Is that even possible? I mean, the trajectory of the last generation or so of time seems to be from optimism about tech as a democratizer of information and power to a wasteland of disinformation, a social media culture ruinous to many young people's mental health, especially girls, a coarse field of hate speech, and Silicon Valley giants' greed, you know, all these things. And we've seen the tech haves and have-nots exacerbate learning inequality in the pandemic remote learning era, that difference. So can tech ever work for all of us, or is the job right now more to minimize its dystopian effects?
We need more humanistic thinking and regulations for it to work for all of us, but I believe it can. Let's take two different issues, the citizenship question and the economic question. On the citizenship question, you pointed some of the things that tech has gotten right. I mean, the fact that we have a Me Too movement, that we have the Black Lives Matter movement on social media, that we have more decentralization of giving people a voice has been a good thing. But there has also been a naivete, an absolute defense of the First Amendment, thinking just having people speak on a platform is somehow going to improve public discourse. And that has been exclusionary, with rampant racism and sexism online, making it hard for people to participate as equals. There has been, as you pointed out, a lot of terrible design, which has led to depression and suicide among teenage girls in particular with Instagram. There's been the targeting of people with their data and making them vulnerable, and that's how you've had the growth of QAnon. So what I have said is you need to have certain rules, both government rules in terms of not allowing the incitement of violence on speech, which still is allowed, in terms of having consumer protection laws, in terms of preventing these companies from getting your data and then targeting you, so that we can improve the public discourse, and antitrust laws, so we have a plurality of discursive speeches. I'll let you respond to that, and then we can get into the economics part of it.
Sure. And listeners, if you're just joining us, my guest is California Congressman Ro Khanna, member of the Progressive Caucus. His district is basically Silicon Valley, and his new book is called Dignity in a Digital Age, Making Tech Work for All of Us. And we can take some phone calls and tweets for Congressman Khanna on this theme of tech working for all of us, or anything else that you want to ask a member of the Progressive Caucus here at this political moment in our country, 212-433-WNYC, 212-433-9692, or tweet at Brian Lehrer. Let me do this next. Let me play a very short clip of Frances Haugen, the Facebook whistleblower, and then a very short clip of Mark Zuckerberg, and get your take on whether both things can be true. Here's Frances Haugen after she revealed some internal Facebook documents.
I saw Facebook repeatedly encounter conflicts between its own profits and our safety. Facebook consistently resolved these conflicts in favor of its own profits. The result has been more division, more harm, more lies, more threats, and more combat. In some cases, this dangerous online talk has led to actual violence that harms and even kills people. This is not simply a matter of certain social media users being angry or unstable, or about one side being radicalized against the other. It is about Facebook choosing to grow at all costs, becoming an almost trillion-dollar company by buying its profits with our safety. During my time at Facebook, I came to realize a devastating truth. Almost no one outside of Facebook knows what happens inside of Facebook. The company intentionally hides vital information from the public, from the U.S. government, and from governments around the world.
So that was about a minute of Frances Haugen. That was a little longer than I thought it was going to be, but here's 20 seconds of Mark Zuckerberg.
I think if you look at the grand arc here, what's really happening is individuals are getting more power and more opportunity to create the lives and the jobs that they want and to connect with people they want and to connect with the ideas that they want and to share the ideas that they want. And I just think that that will lead to a better world.
Zuckerberg, Facebook's creator, of course. So for you, Congressman, are both things kind of true? Can they coexist at all? Or does one person necessarily wind up telling the truth and the other person lying?
I've met Frances Haugen. I think she's telling the truth. The reality is, when it comes to the specific information that she discussed, that Facebook knows that their product is causing depression, suicidal thoughts, and anxiety among teenagers. They know this. They are not taking any action to change it. They could make sure that Instagram wasn't amplifying and putting on steroids our worst experiences in junior high. They're not doing that. They could stop the targeting of teenage girls who may have eating disorders, who may have particular mental health issues. They're not doing that. In my belief, and actually I'm working on a bill right now, is that you ought to have the FTC and the FCC given power to regulate this product. I mean, just like you would any product that was causing consumer harm.
One thing that you write about in the book is the opportunities for individual and family economics through the new work from home era that the pandemic has brought on. And of course, that intersects with the tech capabilities of today to work from home. Can you expand on your vision of that?
This gets to the economic part of can tech work for all of us. We have an economy right now, $11 trillion of market cap in my district. It's gone up 40% during the pandemic. Apple has gone from $1 trillion to $3 trillion. The economy is working for many people in my district, not for all the service workers, but many young folks. They're very optimistic about America. And yet the new economy has not worked for so many people across this country, where you've seen jobs go offshore, deindustrialization, people saying that their kids are having to leave their hometown. They're talking about a brain drain in many parts of this country. And my argument is that we have to make sure these 25 million new digital jobs are decentralized, that we need place-based policy that actually brings these jobs to communities, as opposed to telling people, go move and go leave the towns that you grew up in and may love. And we could do it. Intel going to Ohio is a great example of what I'm talking about, creating 3,000 manufacturing jobs, 7,000 construction jobs, bringing $20 billion there, a part of the economic revival of that part of Ohio. We need more of that and policies that will encourage that.
Did you have a position on Amazon wanting to build a second headquarters in New York City and bring, they said, 20, 25,000 jobs, but it being rejected because people in the nearby neighborhoods feared gentrification?
So I thought it was unfortunate that Amazon, after talking about all the places they would put jobs, were just talking about a few of the big cities where these jobs have already been concentrated. I rather that they had gone across the country in places maybe that didn't have them. But in general, I think these jobs should be welcome if you have a couple stipulations, that they pay well, that there is going to be affordable housing in a community, and that you actually have the opportunities for service workers to make enough wage in these communities that it doesn't get them rent burdened. So overall, I am for tech jobs and tech opportunities with two provisions, good wages and affordable housing.
Christine in Westchester, you're on WNYC with Congressman Ro Khanna. Hi, Christine.
Hi. Can you hear
Hi,
me?
Hi, Christine.
Yep, we got gotcha. Hi, Christine, you're on.
I wanted to speak to the idea of free speech and social media. I'm a progressive. I have other progressive friends who are more, they describe themselves perhaps as like free speech absolutists. On the other hand, I'm very convinced by the work of Shoshana Zuboff and others that demonstrate that social media is not the public square. We're being, you know, manipulated so they can hoover up our information. And in fact, the least truthful information often is what's the most beneficial to the social media companies. Do you have any thoughts about how to bridge this disagreement between people on the left?
I'm a big fan of Shoshana Zuboff's work on surveillance capitalism. I had sent her earlier drafts of my book, and she was helpful in her comments. I would say two things. First, the First Amendment, even under Brandenburg, isn't absolute. You can't have imminent threats of violence. There is no argument, in my view, when Facebook knew before January 6th that there were specific time and place threats on their platform for assassinating lawmakers, that they shouldn't have sat on that information. They should have reported that to the federal government, and they should have removed that from their platform. The fact that they have such broad Section 230 immunity is wrong, and we need to reform Section 230 at least so it doesn't apply to incitement of illegal conduct that's not right under Brandenburg. The second thing I would put out, and this is where I rely on Habermas, who I think is one of the great philosophers of the 20th century and discourse theory, is to get to truth, to get to morality, to have a public sphere, which is a word he actually coined in 1962. It doesn't just mean everyone gets to speak. It means everyone has to speak as an equal, that speech has to have a reciprocity of good intention, that it has to be informed dialogue. And there has been a naivete, in my view, in social media that just put everyone together. And on top of that, monetize it and target people with some types of information, and that's going to have good outcomes. Frankly, if I had one recommendation to the social media companies, I'd say hire philosophy majors, hire humanists, hire liberal arts majors. Embrace the challenge that people have been thinking about how to have thoughtful discourse for generations, and we need to do a much better job of how that would happen on new media platforms.
Christine, thank you for your call. Congressman, you call yourself a progressive capitalist. How is that different from, say, a Bernie Sanders democratic socialist who calls himself a progressive just as you do?
Well, I was a co-chair of Senator Sanders' campaign. I admire him very much, and I support the policies of Medicare for All. I support the policy of free public college. I support $15 minimum wage. And the way I frame these things is these are the basic things that you need to be successful in a market economy. I guess I probably have a little bit more of appreciation or faith in the power of innovation and entrepreneurship. I believe people should be free to trade things in a market, to invent things. You shouldn't have the government making all decisions about an economy. And that's why I embrace sort of innovation and entrepreneurship. I just want to make sure everyone has the shot that I did. Healthcare, education, nutrition, a safe community, to have a real chance of success in this market economy.
You know, the conversation that we had before you came on was about the Spotify, Joe Rogan, Neil Young, Joni Mitchell controversy.
Yes.
And Spotify is not just a platform, but a producer of podcasts now. It has a big stake in Joe Rogan. It isn't just a neutral platform for it. And a listener tweeted near the end of that, the conversation you're having right now is only one reason why the world of Web3 exists, that is music, NFTs, and decentralization. Some of that is still over my head, I have to admit. Particularly, I kind of get NFTs now, I think, but but I've only heard the term Web3 a few times. Is this something you're familiar with, and this does this come into your positive vision of a tech future?
It's something that I am somewhat familiar with, and as I understand NFTs and Web3, it is the idea that you can have blockchain technology allow for the decentralization of transactions. So let me give you a concrete example. Let's say I've written this book, Dignity in a Digital Age, and it needs to be read in different college campuses. Right now, it costs a lot of money. Unfortunately, I have no say over that. It costs $28, $26 to buy the book. What if you could actually have an NFT book that would allow it to be distributed throughout, where someone would still be compensated for their intellectual capital, but it would significantly decrease the cost of the distribution? That strikes me as a good thing. You could see that application in smart contracts. You could see that application in allowing for money transmittances across the world without the same fees. You could see actually creating companies with giving people more ownership by giving them these tokens. Now, there are scams as well in terms of the investment on this, and that needs to be regulated. We need to regulate some of the uses of this for illicit activity. So it has to be well regulated. But I do think the underlying technology does have some value beyond being digital gold.
On the government doing too much to kind of take over the tech industry, take over is much too strong, but to more strongly regulate the tech giants, here's an interesting question from a listener who tweets, would the congressman like to see Donald Trump's FCC and Federal Trade Commission be in charge of social media? Because eventually that's what would happen. Now, whether or not Trump actually gets elected in 2024, eventually there'll be another Republican president who might have a very different approach to the government's relationship with tech. So how much is that, from your progressive standpoint, a risk of getting the government too involved?
Well, it's a risk in that you don't want the government being an arbiter of the truth. That is undoubtedly the case. But the reality is that you can't lose Donald Trump as a test case for any regulation. I mean, he could abuse every regulation. I mean, that's what he tried to do in many cases. And so in that world, you wouldn't have any regulation. I think let's just use a normal Republican, because the challenge with Trump is to make sure he doesn't abuse his authority. There is even in a normal Republican a view that you don't want to give these agencies too much power to censor speech. And I have defended, actually, a lot of even a speech that liberals didn't like it being on these platforms. But just because you don't want to censor viewpoints doesn't mean that you can't have regulations about consumer safety so that you don't have a product that is causing harm to teenagers, or public health safety so you don't have a product that is actually leading to deaths because of misinformation about vaccines. And we have, as you know, because you're on broadcast radio, we have some standards for radio and television. I would argue the standards for the internet probably have to be less because you have millions of people. But it's fair to argue that you need some standards, that it shouldn't just be the Wild West.
Listener tweets for Ro Khanna, what is the role of tech in battling climate change, and what are its downfalls?
On the positive side, we need technological innovation for our climate change. We need to make sure how we can innovate on new batteries, innovate on scaling solar, innovate on the smart grid. So much of the challenge of climate change is not just regulatory, it requires innovation. On a challenging part is the climate disinformation. Let me say two things on social media. One, you have Sunrise Movement, and a lot of the climate activists were using the tools of social media very effectively. So it's allowing mobilization, but you also have huge pockets of climate disinformation on social media. I chair the Environment Subcommittee in Congress. We had big oil hearings about how big oil basically lied to us about climate for the last 40 years. And we're actually going to be having a hearing on social media's role in climate disinformation to explore exactly these issues.
Can you talk a little more about that? What's your premise going in regarding social media's role on climate disinformation?
Well, the premise is that there is a lot of climate disinformation that is out there in the social media space. I mean, there is information that, for example, human activity doesn't cause fossil fuel, doesn't cause climate change. That's just false. Well, what is the obligation of social media companies when it comes to climate disinformation, given their own goals that they care about the Paris Accords? It may be hard there to have a regulatory fix. You may not be able to have the government serve as an arbiter of truth on what is climate disinformation and not. But certainly you could have more editorial responsibility by social media companies themselves. And that's what we will explore in these hearings.
My guest for another few minutes is Congressman Ro Khanna, leader of the Progressive Caucus in the House of Representatives and the representative from the Silicon Valley area and author of a new book called Dignity in a Digital Age. Congressman, a couple of things before you go. One, I want to make sure you get this part of your book out here a little bit. You've written an Internet Bill of Rights. Can you enumerate some of those for us?
Absolutely. The point should be that when you go online, your data should not be taken without your affirmative consent and used in ways to support candidates that you don't support or to target teenagers in ways that you don't support or to be used to create profiles that end up helping grow social media followings on QAnon in ways you don't support. So people often say, well, what difference does it make if it's my data that's being taken? My life is okay. But there's a societal harm to these companies having all of this data, constructing social profiles, and using it to target the most vulnerable. And the Internet Bill of Rights, at first instance, would stop the data accumulation. And I think that would make for a much better public sphere. This is just one step of what would help address this surveillance capitalism that Shoshana Zuboff writes about so brilliantly, but at least it'll mitigate some of those problems.
And last thing, just turning to the politics of 2022, how do you think Democrats can hold Congress this year?
We need to do a better job telling our story. The entire Democratic Party should be in Ohio saying, under President Joe Biden, we brought $20 billion to the Midwest. When did Donald Trump do that? We're bringing new jobs. The job growth is tremendous. The economic recovery is tremendous. We've passed bipartisan infrastructure, something we haven't done in decades. We're getting rural communities connected to broadband. We're making broadband affordable for communities left out. We're removing lead pipes. We had the American Rescue Plan that helped prevent a massive recession, that got people payments, that cut child poverty. We need the Congress to continue progress for working families. And we should resist this. There's this too much gloom and doom, I think, in our party. You know, we are at a point where we have the most diverse Congress ever. We are getting closer to becoming a multiracial, multicultural democracy. Yes, Trump was a huge setback, and there wasn't a linear line from Obama to a multicultural, multiracial democracy. But what we're trying to do has never been done before in the history of the world. We ought to approach it with a sense of optimism that we will get there and a recognition that these are the struggles that we have to go through to do something that's really going to be historically unique.
Congressman Ro Khanna, his new book is called Dignity in a Digital Age, Making Tech Work for All of Us. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing your ideas and taking calls and tweets from our listeners. I really, really appreciate it.
I appreciate your having me. Thank you.
Brian Lehrer on WNYC. Stay with us. It's the Brian Lehrer Show on WNYC. Good morning again, everyone. Dr. Lena Wen is back with us at a very interesting and maybe hopeful moment in the pandemic, with Omicron cases declining precipitously, certainly in the New York area and other parts of the country likely to follow as we got hit first here. But we've seen these moments before, with new variants then popping up to pop our bubbles of optimism and normalcy. So where are we now, and what should we do about it individually and at a policy level? Dr. Wen teaches medicine at George Washington University, is a Washington Post columnist and CNN medical contributor, former health commissioner of Baltimore, and author of the book, Lifelines, A Doctor's Journey in the Fight for Public Health. And we'll talk about her column called Yes, More Variants May Emerge in the Future. That's Why We Should Lift Restrictions Now. Dr. Nguyen, always good to have you. Welcome back to WNYC.
Thank you, Brian. Great to join you as always.
Can I just first get a response, even though I don't think that you heard the previous segment with a Nassau County executive who's against the governor of New York's mask mandate for schools. He asserted that the science indicates that cloth masks and paper masks, as he called them, aren't effective. What is the latest science on that? As far as you know, you have been covering this very closely.
Well, this is becoming quite a nuanced issue, and I do think it's important for us to not get bogged down in the politics. It seems like there have been this increased division of people who are, you're either pro-vaccine, pro-mask, or you're anti-vaccine, anti-mask. I think that there is a nuanced discussion to be had, and specifically, if everyone is wearing high-quality masks, so N95, K95, etc., those masks are extremely protective. They are protective of the individual, so even if others around you are not wearing masks, wearing one of these high-quality masks still protect you very well. But if everyone is wearing high-quality masks, that also makes a much bigger difference than if everybody is wearing not very good masks. It is true that a single layer cloth mask is simply not sufficient. Is it better than nothing? Absolutely. So to say that masks don't have a role isn't true. However, in a time of Omicron, which is extremely contagious, wearing a one-layer cloth mask just is not going to do very much. And so I've been a proponent to say, if you're going to wear a mask at all and to make mask requirements, at least let people know about the masks that are effective for them. Because I don't want people walking around thinking that they are well protected with a single-layer cloth mask when it's not.
The other assertion he made, well, he made many, but the other one I'll ask you about is that the mask mandate wasn't necessary in schools, even at the height of Omicron, because kids don't get very sick from Omicron, basically. What's your position on that?
Again, nuanced answer, which is that we know that Omicron is milder than previous variants, thankfully. We also know that children tend to get much less ill compared to adults. However, we also know that throughout the pandemic, nearly 1,000 children, according to the CDC, have died. More than 6,000 have been diagnosed with this multi-system inflammatory syndrome since the beginning of the pandemic around the country. And to say that we shouldn't do easy things in order to protect our kids isn't right. However, I also think that we need to have an off-ramp for masking, including and especially in our schools, because that trade-off of wearing masks, especially for our youngest children, is something that we need to have an honest conversation about. So I disagree with your previous guest in saying that there was never any use for masks. Certainly pre-vaccine, there was absolutely a use for masks because we didn't have these safe and effective vaccines. But now that everyone 5 and older is able to be vaccinated, we do also have to have a conversation about what it is that vaccines can replace. Can it replace, for example, required masking?
So your article, and I'll read the title and we'll cut to the chase. The title again is, Yes, More Variants May Emerge in the Future. That's Why We Should Lift Restrictions Now. What restrictions do you have in mind?
Yeah, so I want to start with a place of saying, here are the two things that I don't want to see happen, right? Sometimes this conversation is framed in the binary of, let's just let it rip and let's not care about COVID anymore. I don't think that that's right. I mean, we have thousands of people dying every day from COVID. We have an obligation to protect the immunocompromised, those who are medically vulnerable, the elderly. So we can't do that. But at the same time, we also cannot live in 2020 or early 2021 mode, pre-vaccine mode, where everything is about infection control. We're entering year 3 of this pandemic, and we have to acknowledge the many costs of continuing to prioritize infection control above all else, which is we've had our schools closed, we've had such damage to our economy, we've had the opioid epidemic and childhood obesity that were already major problems escalate because all of our attention has been focused on, and perhaps rightly so, earlier on COVID. And so my point of view is that there is a middle path, if you will, that we have to craft, which is that when we see that there are cases steadily declining, and especially when we see that hospitalizations are down to the point that in a particular region, those hospitals are no longer overwhelmed, that we have to end the state of emergency and let people have some level of normalcy. You know, some will cite that the potential for new variants is why we have to keep restrictions in place. But I think it's because of the threat of variants in the future that we have to let up while we can. And we should remove restrictions as quickly as we place them, because that helps us to preserve public health authority for when it's needed again with new threats. And I think that now is a good time, especially in places like New York and D.C. and Maryland, where I am, where numbers are clearly trending down, to have a very clear off-ramp for all restrictions for vaccinated people, because we know that vaccinated and boosted people are at very low risk for severe outcomes from COVID-19.
Listeners, we invite your calls for Dr. Lena Nguyen. What have you been doing the last 2 months to adjust to the Omicron variant? And what are you doing or planning to do differently as it wanes? 212-433-WNYC, 212-433-9692, or tweet at Brian Lehrer. Also, parents of children under 5, are you ready to get your really little ones vaccinated? 6 months and up is what Pfizer says their vaccine could be approved for now. We'll get to that with Dr. Nguyen. Parents of children 6 months to 5 years, are you ready? Or what questions do you have? 212-433-WNYC, 212-433-9692. You acknowledge in your column, Dr. Nguyen, that people... immunocompromised people cannot let their guard down. But if the rest of society does in the way that you just outlined, where does that leave them?
Yeah, it's a really important question. And I think here is there is a short-term answer and a medium-term answer. The short-term answer is that for people who are medically vulnerable, including people who are severely immunocompromised, who have other many chronic medical conditions, who are elderly, We do need to advise that they continue to hunker down, because there is a lot of virus around us at the moment. That includes continuing to take additional precautions, including, very importantly, wearing that high quality mask when in indoor crowded spaces, perhaps when you are visiting with other individuals, for example, other people, relatives, friends are coming over for dinner, having them take a rapid test right before seeing you will help to reduce risk as well. Now, that is not sustainable, and I fully recognize that all along in this pandemic, this pandemic has affected people unequally. And we need for the Biden administration to put all their effort behind making antiviral treatments readily available. There is Evusheld, an antibody treatment that's given to immunocompromised people that can work for at least, it looks like, 6 months in terms of giving people antibodies, even if they cannot produce antibodies on their own. That exists, but we need far more of this supply. We need a lot more tests. We need free masks. I mean, all of these things are what we need in order to treat individuals who are medically frail, to prevent them from becoming severely ill. I believe that can be done in the next few months, such that by the end of spring, early summer, those who are immunocompromised will also be able to enjoy the freedoms that everybody else has too. And you were mentioning about parents of young kids. I've got two little kids of my own. Right now, my husband and I have been living, as many families have, in a state of fear, because we have been taking so many precautions to protect our young kids. Essential for us to get our kids vaccinated. But until then, I don't want for everybody else to hold back on what they're able to do in order to protect my family. I don't want school kids to have to stay home from school. I don't want the economy to have to suffer out of deference to my children. So it's a matter of time for my kids. It's a matter of time for the immunocompromised. Everybody else, once hospitalizations in that area are trending down, I hope that they will be able to resume some level of normality.
Tori in Cornwall, New York. You're on WNYC with Dr. Lena Nguyen. Hi, Tori.
Hi. So I am a progressive Democrat. My kids are vaccinated. My son will be boosted tomorrow. I am against these masks now. I think enough is enough. My daughter loves singing, and to see her sing on stage with the mask on when the rest of the world and are going about their business and going to games and concerts and everything is heartbreaking. our kids are little for only so long. Our family's done everything we could have been asked. Now is the time to take them off. It's just enough is enough.
Did you feel that way a month ago at the height of Omicron, Tori, or is this coming to you now as it starts to wane?
I kind of felt it. I think when I saw her singing at her concert and when I saw the pictures of people attending games and basketball games and a host of other things, and I was like, enough is enough. And so, yes, I've kind of felt like this for the last couple of months as my kids are gearing up and going back into school and getting on with their activities.
And you mentioned to our screener that both your kids are boosted. So that changed your mindset, too, once they got those?
I was kind of like, we've done everything we've been asked. My daughter's not because she's not quite old enough yet, but my son will be tomorrow. I think after that happened, I was like, no, our family's done what we were asked. You know, everybody else can get vaccinated. With they can the do shots. What they choose or not to do. And honestly, the number of parents who's going to get their kids vaccinated, it's not going to budge that much.
Tori, thank you so much for your call. We really appreciate it. And Dr. Nguyen, she may be the poster person for your argument, liberal Democrat who got her kids vaccinated and when age eligible boosted, arguing for being done with the masks. What do you say to the argument that Omicron has shown itself capable of breaking through the vaccine much more than anyone anticipated?
Well, but let's talk about what it is that we care about at the end of the day. What we care about is preventing severe illness and death. We are now dealing with the variant that's dominant. Omicron, by far, is still the dominant variant here in the U.S. and around the world. It is milder than previous variants. People who are vaccinated and boosted are extremely well protected from severe illness due to Omicron. And so I really hear Tori's frustration. It's frustration that I hear from so many of my colleagues and friends and pediatricians and infectious disease doctors and educators who are basically saying, why is it that people who are vaccinated and boosted, who have done everything right during this pandemic, who are now having to pay the price for people who choose to remain unvaccinated, because those are the individuals who are at highest risk now. In addition, why is it that children are having to pay the price when we see adults are going about their daily lives and going to bars and concerts unmasked in many cases? Why is it that children are still staying masked when everybody 5 and older is able to be vaccinated? They are well protected from severe illness. The chance of them getting severely ill, full stop, is low, but also individuals can choose to mask if they wish, and that mask will protect them very well. There is a movement of physicians and educators called the Urgency of Normal, specifically to address what Tori mentioned, which is maybe it's time, beyond time, actually, to let our children have a normal existence. And I think that it's important to have this conversation because the people who are raising it are not anti-maskers. They're not anti-vaxxers. They're people saying good health and a good life is not just the absence of COVID. We need to look at the trade-offs that our restrictions have had. Now entering year 3 of this pandemic, let's have an honest conversation that's evidence-based about what is good for our children, especially going forward.
Pfizer is seeking approval for the vaccine for kids as young as 6 months old. Is it ready, in your opinion?
I don't know is the honest answer because we have not seen any data. Usually when the pharmaceutical companies have applied for authorization from the FDA, they've released some kind of press release of some kind showing what data they have. We don't have anything. Based on what I understand thus far, we may be in for positive data because actually of the sheer number of infections in recent months that we may be able to see perhaps that there is a substantial reduction in illness for children with 2 doses of the vaccine. I would love to see that. I think the concern that many of us have is what was stated by Pfizer earlier was that they are studying the vaccine as a 3-dose vaccine, especially for children in this 2 to 4-year-old group. I'm not sure how you can approve a three-dose vaccine until you have three-dose data. So I hope that they'll either have those data or they'll have the data for what two doses show. As in, if you can see that two doses will reduce, let's say, hospitalization, that might be sufficient. But I really want to see what those data show rather than speculate. And I'm really looking forward to this FDA meeting. What I will say is that I have full faith in the process. I have faith in the FDA. I have faith in the CDC. I am certain that they're going to make sure that the vaccines are safe and they're going to be effective prior to approval. And I cannot wait for that moment when I'm able to give my children the excellent protection that older kids and my husband and I and adults have been able to enjoy.
Jeff in Brooklyn, you're on WNYC with Dr. Lena Nguyen. Hi, Jeff.
Hi. I live in New York City. I live in a neighborhood that was hit fairly hard in the first 2 years of the pandemic, compared to the surrounding neighborhoods. I also am vaccinated and am very much for masking pretty much all the time, and I'm only using KN95s now. I also weekly go up to Westchester to visit my family, in particular my grandmother, to take care of her, who is completely against vaccination and thinks of masking as very inconvenient, as well as some of my aunts, uncles, and cousins are along those lines. So whenever I am taking care of her, I have a heavy mask on, and it makes for difficulty for communicating since she's an octogenarian. Is there anything that I might look forward to not have to worry that I'm a danger to her in taking care of her as an elder?
Yeah, it's a really good question. And I appreciate the way that you frame this as well, because there are many people in our lives who, for whatever reason, are choosing to remain unvaccinated. We want them to be vaccinated, but we also want to keep on interacting with them and caring for them and loving them at the same time. And so I think there needs to be guidance, too, on how can we do so in a way that's safe to them and safe to us as well. So a couple of things that you could do. One thought is, especially if for people who are generally healthy, if you have other people in your household that you interact with on a regular basis who are generally healthy, you could say, well, the chance to me of getting severely ill from interacting with people who are unvaccinated is relatively low. And so because it's so important to me to take care of these unvaccinated individuals, I will bear that risk and even go maskless. Now, that is one choice. I understand that that's not a choice that many people will make, but it is one choice. Another choice is to say, especially in your case, because you're concerned about your elderly, about your elderly family who are unvaccinated and at risk themselves, you could get a rapid test prior to seeing them, especially as case numbers become lower. I believe it would be reasonable to say that the rapid test can replace the need for masking. As in, think about all of this, as we talked about all along, Brian, as these are layers of protection. And so you need a lot of layers when there's a lot of virus around us. But when the levels of virus begin to decrease, then if you're vaccinated and you get a test, I think it would be reasonable to say that that could replace the need for masking. So those are all the options that are on the table. And again, I appreciate this conversation because I think so much of the conversation or so much of the discussion has been polarizing in terms of what the policies should be. But for those of us who live in the real world with complicated situations, it's helpful to navigate, to have guidance to navigate those situations.
All right. We will have to leave it there with Dr. Lena Nguyen, who teaches at George Washington University. She's a Washington Post columnist and CNN medical contributor, former health commissioner of Baltimore, and author of the book, Lifelines, A Doctor's Journey in the Fight for Public Health. We always appreciate it, Dr. Nguyen. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Brian.
And we'll continue to take some of your phone calls right now with your own off-ramps and how you're adjusting to this moment when it's been 2 years and when the Omicron variant is starting to wane. So, listeners, if you were holding on to ask Dr. Nguyen a question, please hang up and let other people get through. But if you were calling to tell a story, as some of you were, you can hang on and others can call, too, on what you've been doing the last 2 months to adjust to the Omicron variant and what you're doing or planning to do differently as it wanes. 212-433-WNYC, 212-433-9692. And if you're a parent of children under five, are you ready to get your really little ones vaccinated? 212-433-9692. 9692. And Millie on the Upper West Side, you're on WNYC. Hi, Millie.
Hi, Brian. Thank you for taking my call. Always happy to catch Dr. Wen. My daughter is a preschool teacher, an experienced preschool teacher in Manhattan on the West Side. And we were just having this discussion last night that this is just the beginning of the studies that are going to come about years from now. These young children who have spent 2 years of their very important, you know, years where their lives and their brains and their attitudes and their whole beings are being formed 3 and 4 and 5 with masks, and whether or not they're germophobes or afraid to touch anyone, or that the whole thing. You've had teachers and healthcare workers on before, and we all know that, you know, God bless our healthcare workers and our teachers. I think are pretty much right behind it, because I hear my daughter, and you know, she's wonderful with these kids, but oh man, every single day the emails and the changes and all this stuff with the kids. Eventually, yes, there has to be an off ramp. That I actually dialed the phone, Brian, mm-hmm. when I heard the four words, quote unquote, from Dr. Wen. We need to have a quote, a very clear off ramp, unquote. Absolutely, like your last caller said. Also, it's not just. We're not hearing this from Republicans. We're hearing this from liberal Democrats. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. The fact that liberal Democrats are starting to say a similar thing, obviously, is Millie's point. Michael in Westchester, you're on WNYC. Hi, Michael.
Hi, Brian. Thank you so much for all these great conversations you're having. One recurring conversation that was in both this and the prior one with the county executive, and I've heard, you know, and read in New York Times op-eds, is this conversation around children and their well-being when it comes to COVID. But we're talking about just New York public schools, tens of thousands of adults that work in these schools. And every time this conversation happens, we forget to mention all the adults that are in, and as well as you did reference it, that, you know, these children return home to families with, you know, compromised parents or grandparents. Mm-hmm. So I just think, like, whenever we have this conversation, we can't talk about schools without talking about the hundreds of thousands and across the country, the millions of people who work in our schools. When it comes to off-ramp, I think the hospitalization is a key, you know, factor to always be looking at.
Michael, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Yeah, one of the things we didn't have time to get to with Dr. Wen before she had to go was the part of her Washington Post article that says there are two approaches here. One is gradual and based on case numbers and test positivity. She writes, communities can identify two thresholds for transmission. At the higher level, there should be 2 out of 3 protective measures, vaccine, testing, or masking. Individuals should be doing at least 2 of them. Workplaces and schools that require vaccines and that have regular testing can do away with masks. She wrote, at the lower level, that is the lower level of spread, 1 out of 3 is enough, such that vaccines or testing alone can replace the need for masks in her model. That's one model. And then she wrote another approach, which she wrote that she's beginning to favor, is to state that every person 5 and older can be vaccinated and high-quality masks can protect individuals well. Therefore, masks can be optional, not required, even at high rates of community transmission. The threshold for re-implementing indoor masking would shift from case numbers to hospital capacity in that model. And she writes, of course, masking could also return if a deadlier variant arises that evades prior immunity. So more of the thoughts from Dr. Wen. Aaliyah in Brooklyn, you're on WNYC. Hi, Aaliyah.
Hey, Ryan. Aaliyah and my daughter on the phone here.
And another child makes their radio debut on the Brian Lehrer Show. What's your daughter's name?
She loves your theme song, Gaetana.
Hi, Gaetana. I'm a disembodied voice. Hi, Gaetana. Go ahead, Leah.
Brian, that's really exciting. Brian, I'm calling as an educator and as a mother. And look, I teach in a number of different schools. I go in as a teaching artist. And at one school, NYU, I go in, all of my students are vaccinated. There's super high levels of testing, and I feel super safe, masking or unmasked, really. But the other day, I go into a high school, and none of my students are vaccine required. And in this community, many of them aren't vaccinated. And if they were to shift to no mask requirement, I would be really frightened going into that school and then coming home to Gaetana, who is too young to be vaccinated. And again, echoing your last caller, what do the people that whose work and livelihood depend on showing up in these environments do when these mask requirements for, you know, as your last caller said, her daughter who's in the choir doesn't want to wear a mask anymore? It's just a catch-22, I feel.
Leah, thank you very much. Let's go to Dan in Manhattan, who I think owns a restaurant. Is that right, Dan?
Yes, I do. Can you
Hi.
Hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. I'm following the CDC rules to the note. I am also, everybody in my restaurant is fully vaccinated and has masks. And another thing that's very important, we have children that come in here too. We get calls daily asking if we're fully vaccinated and if we have masks for available. We have to keep masks available for any customers coming in. So I can't agree with this idea that there's this strong urge out there when Lena, this doctor, has come out and said right in her own Washington Post, you can no longer count on the CDC rules to keep you safe. So we can't have it both ways. And we give N95 to all our employees, and we won't let you in the door if you will not wear a mask and if you're not fully vaccinated. And once again, that's what our customers want. And I'm a person who's had a sister die from this 2 years ago. A neighbor of mine just died recently from COVID. And I'm at ground zero up here in Washington Heights, ground zero. Mm-hmm. And I just don't see this, quote, turn of progressive Democrats saying, you know, burning their masks or something. It's really, I don't believe it. And I think it's a great way of keeping people safe. And by the way, I have two children in school. Every week I get a message from the school saying how somebody just caught the Omicron virus. And let's not fool ourselves. We can have another variant come in. You know what I'm saying? So I'm all for masks. Children are very resilient. I don't believe they're being greatly damaged, but I don't want to get into that. I could tell you, if anyone did a quick search on Google, you will see hundreds of studies on how good masks are from you, hundreds of them from very, very, very capable organizations, universities, and yes, the CDC. And I have a feeling this is against Fauci, a lot of this stuff. But I don't want to Joe Roganize this whole debate, you know? So,
right. I mean, it is interesting that Dr. Nguyen, and there was a liberal New York Times columnist who wrote a similar thing the other day on taking an off-ramp at this moment, at least, when Omicron is really fading, and especially for children. So there is more conversation about this, especially with respect to masking in schools across the political spectrum right now. But to one of your points that we shouldn't let get lost, Dr. Nguyen did make the point very clearly in her column that one of the reasons to do this is because more deadly variants might be lurking around the corner, and we have to be ready to mask up again more fully if that does occur, if one does come along. And that's a reason to ease up right now to give people a little bit of a break.
See, I'm not for that. I think we should keep it floored and keep people safe.
Let me ask you one other thing about your restaurant. I guess you know, you say you're seeing your customers do want to mask up. The libertarian position would be, well, there are going to be restaurants like yours where that's the culture that develops of the clientele. There are going to be other restaurants where people don't want to wear masks, and let people self-sort in that respect. What would you say about that?
I would say, well, if I'm going to think like a libertarian, go put your business wherever you want. But there is something that we're all missing here. The last administration here said before they left, de Blasio said, we have not lifted any of our restrictions. They still really are in place. So I could have a health inspector come in and say, where's your mask? Where's your sanitizers? Where's your list? Where's your reservations? We keep reservations on everybody. So I believe we're doing everything that our customers would want, that our employees would want. And, but yeah, take your business elsewhere. I'm sorry, I can't give you the service.
And of course, it is always about the workers, right? Because the patrons have a choice where to eat, whether to dine out at all. The workers, if they're going to make a living and keep a job, you know, they have no choice. They have to be in there with them. So let me ask you one last question, which is how much good, in your experience as a restaurateur, does the masking do in a restaurant where, after all, people have to have it off to eat?
How much good does it do? I think it does a tremendous good, because you see how people, like when they get up to go to the bathroom, they do put their mask on. I think it keeps people on their toes. We used to have a lot of milling around because people know each other in the neighborhood. They don't get up and do that anymore, which is okay. But like I say, I think it's doing good, if that's the question. I think it's doing a tremendous good. And people become more vigilant, you know. I should tell you, too, my employees will not wait on anybody who's not fully vaccinated and has a mask. They just come up to me and say, I'm not waiting on that person. So thank you, Dan. Thank you very much.
And that's where I guess the Lena Wenz of the world will depart from our previous guest, Bruce Blakeman, the Republican Nassau County executive, and the Bruce Blakemans of the world, which is he's pro-vaccination. He set up more vaccination availability pods in Nassau County, he says. But from what I read, he's not enforcing the vaccine mandate in public places. And Dr. Wen says the vaccine mandates should remain in place, and that's one of the keys to unmasking. So the conversation goes on. Obviously, as the pandemic goes on, we will keep having it here. Thanks for all your calls on today's edition. Brian Lehrer on WNYC. The show continues. Thanks for listening to Brian Lehrer Weekend. We're back on the radio Monday morning at 10 a.m. In the meantime, follow us on Twitter at Brian Lehrer or facebook.com/Brian Lehrer WNYC, where there's always a conversation 24/7.